Penguin Random House Audio presents The Long Prison Journey of Leslie Van Houten, Life Beyond the Cult, by Karlene Faith. Read for you by Gabra Zackman. Dedicated to Jane Van Houten. Chronology. August 23, 1949, Leslie Van Houten born. August 10, 1969. Leslie, age 19. Leno and Rosemary LaBianca murdered. October 1969. Leslie, age 20. Arrested in Inyo County on suspicion of theft. December 1969. Connected to the LaBianca murders. Transferred to Sybil Brand Institute, jail, in Los Angeles. June 1970 to April 1971. Remained at the Sybil Brand Institute through pretrial and trial. April 19, 1971. Leslie, age 21. Sentenced to death and thereafter transferred to death row at the California Institution for Women to await execution in the San Quentin gas chamber. February 1972. Leslie, age 22. California State Supreme Court abolished death penalty, reinstated 1976. Leslie's sentence converted to life in prison. June 1972. U.S. Supreme Court outlawed capital punishment nationally for 4 years. 1974. Leslie, age 24. Leslie completely disassociated from Charles Manson. 1976. Leslie, age 26. Transferred to the main prison at California Institution for Women. 1976. Lawyer Maxwell Keith succeeds in overturning original sentence. Leslie returned to Sybil Brand Institute to await second trial. January 1977. Leslie, age 27. Second trial begins. September 1977. Leslie, age 28. Second trial ends with deadlocked jury. December 27, 1977, Leslie freed on bail. March 1978, third trial begins. July 5, 1978, Leslie returned to Sybil Brand Institute to await sentencing, convicted on 2 counts of felony robbery murder, and returned to California Institution for Women. Early 2001, Leslie, age 51, remains in prison. Introduction. This is a book about Leslie Van Houten, who 3 decades ago gained infamy as one of the Manson girls. She was 19 years old when she participated in murder. She has been imprisoned since October 1969, except for 6 months in early 1978 when she was out on bail, before and during her third trial. I met Leslie in 1972 when I was tutoring and doing research at the California Institution for Women. CIW. In February 1972, the California State Supreme Court abolished the death penalty, so Leslie's sentence of death was reduced to life in prison. Virginia Carlson, the warden at CIW, wanted to institute programs for these new lifers and asked me to tutor the 3 women who were still being held on death row. Then known as the Manson girls, Leslie Van Houten, Susan Atkins, and Patricia Krenwinkel had been convicted with Charles Manson and Charles Tex Watson, who was convicted separately, for the 1969 murders of 7 strangers in their homes. Charles Manson spent much of his life in reformatories and prisons for common street crimes, burglary, car theft, forgery, pimping. In 1967, in his mid-30s, he was free on parole. In 1968, he was the unlikely spiritual guru of a cult. And in 1969, he orchestrated 2 nights of brutal murder, including the highly publicized mass murder at the home of Sharon Tate, where 5 people were killed. Fear gripped the Los Angeles area as details were reported ad nauseum. The accused, in addition to Manson, were 3 of the many young girls and 1 of the young men who had been living in a commune led by Manson, referred to by the press as the family. Leslie Van Houten was not present at the Tate murders. She did, however, accompany two other Manson disciples on the second night of murder. This book does not minimize the horror of what happened to Rosemary and Leno LaBianca in the wee hours of August 10, 1969. But my first aim is to clarify the events that led to Leslie's and the others' participation in that tragedy and Manson's effects on them. More personally, I offer a portrait of the Leslie I have known, from a time before Charles Manson lost his power over her to the present. This version of the life of a Manson girl differs from other versions, in that I learned the stories firsthand over decades. During the 30 years following the murders, many changes have occurred in Leslie's life. In the mid-1970s, she completely separated from Manson's power. She then began the hard work of realizing what she'd done and of doing penance. She matured quietly and gracefully through young adulthood and middle age, making a life within her prison community. Those who believe she should have been put to death for her crime are understandably angry that she, unlike her victims, has had the opportunity to mature at all, even if in the harsh conditions of prison. I argue that unless punishment is meant to be limitless, it is time for her to be paroled. Most of what is known about Leslie by those over age 50, in the year 2000, is what they saw sensationalized in the press or on TV at the time of the crime and the first trial, and from a mass-market book written a few years later by Vincent Bugliosi, the prosecutor of four of the five Manson defendants. This age group might remember stories about a trio of girls who jeered at the judge. Girls who, on the command of Manson, like robots, shaved their heads to show solidarity. Most of what is known about Leslie by those who are younger than 50 is simply a vague image of one of the so-called Manson girls who murdered for Charlie, an image based on Manson lore and mythology that has been transmitted from one generation to another, often on the internet. In prisoner education and human rights work over the years since the early 1970s, I've encountered thousands of women and hundreds of men in various U.S. and Canadian prisons. Hundreds of them have struck me as unusually gifted or strong in character. Leslie Van Houten is an especially remarkable person, both because of who she is today and because of how she got that way. I make this assertion while understanding why many readers might protest any affirmation of any kind for any reason of anyone involved with Charles Manson. Anne Near. For years, Leslie and I talked about doing a book together. By 1980, I'd been gathering notes for 7 years, and Leslie had ideas on how we might structure her story. Yet I was confounded about how to begin until I began talking with my friend, Anne Near, whose perspective I valued. Her full life has included being a wartime factory worker, a demonstrator at peace marches, a rancher and rancher's wife, a record company co-manager, a mother of four and grandmother of five, a human rights, community, and arts activist, a mentor to many, and an author. Now retired, Anne turned 84 in 2000. Anne and I had been transcribing my interviews with women in prison. She rightly questioned the value of working on Leslie's story because Leslie was unlike most other women in the prison. She came from a middle-class background, and her life seemed to have been idyllic until her adolescence. Also, her sensationalized crime was altogether unusual. A woman accused of murdering strangers has been a rare phenomenon in the history of crime. It is not difficult to understand the circumstances of crimes such as theft or drug possession, or even domestic murder. But it is difficult to understand how a woman could attempt to murder a stranger. The year before I began teaching and doing research at CIW, I had taught at Soledad State Prison. At Soledad, I felt perfectly at ease with men who had murdered, while believing I was the kind of person who could never kill anyone. But when I first started working at CIW in 1972, I heard stories of situations that could have happened to any woman. Leslie's conviction, however, was for something profoundly out of the ordinary. Though in 1980 I had been acquainted with Leslie, Susan, and Patricia for 8 years, I hadn't talked with them about the crimes since 1973. And except for a few of their family members and mutual friends, I rarely spoke with anyone on the outside about them. Because I valued Anne's opinions, and because she was interested in my work with women in prison, we engaged in a series of taped dialogues about crime, women, punishment, and prison life. Anne's questions eventually helped me focus on how to draw meaning from the horrific events that had brought Leslie and the others to prison.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.